Welcome to the People Over Perks podcast by Leapsome. I'm Andy Parker and I'm your host. In each episode, we have a different HR or people operations leader come on the show and tell us the behind the scenes secrets as to how they are building a high performance culture in their organization. In this first episode, we have Till Neatby, the co-founder and head of culture from Marley Spoon. Till shares the details on how they've scaled to over 1,500 employees, how the head of culture role came about, and how they use employee engagement surveys and a whole lot more. Enjoy this conversation. Excellent. So Till, thank you for joining us on the People Over Perks podcast.
Hi, Andy. Nice. Thanks for having me. Nice to meet you.
And so to begin with, tell me whereabouts are you right now and where in the world?
I'm sitting in my Berlin flat, in the study of my Berlin flats. I'm working from the home office right now. We have our offices in Berlin and most other cities open at the moment. Usually I spend 2 days per week at the office and the rest of the time I work from the home office, so currently at home.
Okay, excellent. And so you are the co-founder and head of culture at Marley Spoon. Before we jump into to some of the topics that obviously we're going to discuss around people operations and culture and HR, to begin with, can you tell us what Marley Spoon is?
So we always say we bring delightful, market fresh and easy cooking back to the people while building a sustainable supply chain for waste-free world. So a lot of things that, we're trying to achieve. So on the one hand side, we help our customers to cook better at home. We deliver all the ingredients that you need. We inspire with new recipes on a weekly basis. We really take care of all that whole topic, take the hassle out of the cooking, send it home. And at the same time, we are fighting food waste. We are trying to shorten the supply chain, or we are shortening the supply chain by directly connecting customers to producers. And that's what we do in a nutshell.
Okay, thank you for that. And just so that everyone listening can understand, can you tell me a bit about the scale of Marley Spoon? I know it's an international business, and you recently also had a big milestone in Q2 that I saw was publicly announced around the company being profitable for the first time.
Yes, indeed. Yes, we're operating in 8 countries globally. We have roughly 1,500 team members. We grew within the first half of this year, we grew roughly 90% to about 160 million euros in revenue for the first half of this year. Q2, even 73 million in revenue. So on a nice upward trend there right now. This all equivalents to 21 million meals, I believe, that we shipped in the first half of this year.
Wow, okay.
So quite a few number of boxes.
Yes, I can imagine. Absolutely. Excellent. And so let's talk a little bit about your role specifically then. As the co-founder and head of culture, obviously the co-founders of any business implicitly typically set the culture, or at least are a large contributor to what the culture becomes. But what made you decide to explicitly give yourself a head of culture title?
I agree that the founders do play a certain role in creating a company culture. At the same time, though, culture is built on a daily basis by the whole team. Really, that's something that we try to emphasize always. And when onboarding new people, that it's really all of us building the culture on a daily basis.
Okay.
I had a bunch of different roles at Marley Spoon, as you can imagine, when you start a company. So 1.5 years ago, my co-founder Fabian and me decided to focus on our culture and people team, and that's when I took on that role. And we explicitly wanted to have the word culture in there to emphasize the importance that we believe company culture at the end has on building a good team and company success in the end.
Okay, and was this something that an area of expertise of yours, or something that you, between you and your co-founders, felt that it was something that a co-founder should oversee?
Rather the latter, to be honest. We always, over the last couple of years, brought in a lot of experts from outside that at the end know a lot of things much better than we as the founders do. And that's a little bit the same case here in our culture and people operations team. We have a large number of highly, highly skilled, amazing people in my team that know classical traditional HR area much better than me. No, I didn't have a particular background, but I've been building companies over the last 20 years. I've worked in numerous management functions. So I have a good idea of what I believe is important. But again, there is a lot of experts in the team that know most details much better than me.
Okay. So let's dive into that then. Obviously, as you touched on with 1500 team members across the company, you obviously need a strong people operations team to support that. What does the structure of that team look like?
So we have a bit of a matrix organization overall at Marley Spoon. So we have, on the one hand side, we have regional teams. We have an Australian team, a US team, and a European team. And we have local CEOs for all of these regions. And we have local head of culture and people operations team that report on the one hand side directly into that local CEO role. On the other hand, we're currently in the process of creating the position of a CHRO that's also part of the executive team. And so that eventually you will have this matrix organization set up where you have two direct lines, one to the regional CEO and one to the CHRO in a central function.
I see. Okay.
And then of course, you know, on a more functional level, on the one side, you have your operational service centers which traditionally, we had to focus on most in the past. We always had a rather lean setup. But at the same time, we are running, we're operating 7 fulfillment centers globally, and a huge part of our team are the production associates, our team members at the fulfillment centers actually picking and packing our boxes. So it was always very, very important, of course, to focus on really operating these fulfillment centers and onboarding team members for these sites. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, of course, we have our HR business partners, we have our center of excellence or community of expertise, where we try to focus on individual areas.
Okay, that makes sense. Thank you. And so you touched on the fact that you're looking for a CHRO. Why is now the right time for that role?
Well, we've luckily already identified a very, very good candidate. And we believe that, you know, we have reached a certain level of maturity as a company. At the end of the day, you know, this topic was always a very, very important one for us at Marley Spoon, really from day one, a focus topic for Fabian and me. But we have grown now to a certain size where we really feel that certain processes are getting more and more complex. It is not the same to run a team of 5 people or 50 people or 1500 people, and we're growing strongly. We still believe we're at the very beginning of a long journey. So we decided to take the step now. We could have taken that a year ago already or a year into the future, but I think it's definitely a good signal also internally that we are even doubling down on our efforts with regards to culture and our team and people, our team members.
Okay. And did you have any specific requirements for that role that you're willing to share? Like what is the makeup of that person?
We were looking for someone with, on the one hand side, with a very large experience in this area. So we really wanted someone that had the experience of running such a function in a large organization, in an organization larger than ours. Mm-hmm. At the same time, we are a very agile company. We still consider ourselves to be a startup in a lot of ways. So you have to be able to work very hands-on, very autonomously,
not necessarily with a huge support staff that you might have in larger companies. So that was very important for us that the person joining us brings all of this.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. And so coming back to the processes that you say that need to be in place to create a high performing culture. Can you talk me through a little bit about what the calendar looks like as such for you? What are some of the people operations processes that your team is in control of, and how does that operate throughout the year?
So we have a number of processes that we organize as a culture and people operations team, but where the ownership then at the end sits within the teams or with every single team lead. So we have, for example, everyone at Marley Spoon is doing at least a monthly one-on-one on a culture level, on a team building level. So it's not the weekly Joe fix where you talk about operational stuff, about have you done this, what's the plan for the next week, but it's really this: how are you doing? What can I do to help you? And how happy are you with your development at Marley Spoon, etc. So it's really this very, very open communication where we really expect every team lead to do that at least on a monthly basis with team members. We have formalized processes such as 360 degree reviews between team members, leads, people on the same level above, below.
And how frequently do they happen?
So we do them always after 3 months for new joiners. We do them always for role changes. Mm-hmm. And we encourage leads to do them on a regular basis. Very often, most of them do them on a yearly basis to get feedback. And they are anonymous, so people can do them completely anonymous over the tool. I personally always write my name underneath when I give feedback. We tell people that it doesn't have to be anonymous, but for some people it feels more secure and there's more open communication. And then there is a bunch of smaller cultural topics, donut dates or something that we've, especially now in this COVID-19 situation. We had that before, but we encourage that now even more so, that randomly people meet up when you don't have this meeting at the coffee machine anymore, at the water cooler, that now at least you have this random 20 minutes, half an hour with someone in the company where you really chat about you and not about what do I need to get done this week. And then there is a bunch of other like regular meetings where we are supporting. We have a weekly TGIF, a whole hands on deck meeting that we always have on Friday, where really all team members participate, where we always communicate big updates to the company. Mm-hmm. So again, it's not this is not a culture and people operations meeting, but we're the ones facilitating it. Weekly team meetings, monthly MBRs, business reviews, quarterly business reviews. Quarterly OKR sessions is something that we facilitate also with the tools that we have, using Leapsome in this case, where we really everyone on a quarterly basis aligns goals. It's top down, bottom up at the same time. Mm-hmm. So this is some of the processes that we do. Monthly lunch and learn sessions is something that we've recently introduced from my team, where we said, hey, topic XYZ, remotely, of course, that people from all over the world can learn about specific topic, upvote topics that they want to learn more about. So this is like some of the topics that we do on a regular basis.
Excellent. And so just to jump back to the random coffee meetings, did I catch it correctly that you're using the Slack donut app to match people?
Yeah. Yes, that's correct. And it's really I find it quite amazing. I mean, especially like before Corona crisis, we had them localized. So I would meet up with other people from the Berlin office and we would actually go outside, go for a walk, grab a coffee, walk along the canal, Paulinke Ufer, beautiful, really nice. I always was much looking forward to this, like half hour of, you know, to get some fresh air and exchange a few ideas. But what's also nice now that you know that we can't really do this in person anymore, or not as much anymore, that we've extended that where it works time zone wise. So just this week, actually beginning of this week, I had a donut date with someone from our fulfillment center in Texas, where a lady that started with us 2.5 years ago as a production associate, really on the line picking and packing boxes, and worked her way up to become a team lead there. And it was super refreshing, you know, to talk to someone there, to hear how they are experiencing the whole situation at the very moment, and to really get a completely different view of the topics that we're facing at the very moment. So that I quite enjoyed.
Yeah, really cool. And I imagine that's great learning for you, and obviously nice as well for you know, the employees that randomly get matched with you.
And she was a bit surprised, I have to say.
Yeah. Excellent. And I wanted to come back to the topic of OKRs. Could you tell me a little bit about Marley Spoon's OKR setting process? And you mentioned how you facilitate these quarterly meetings. But what does that process look like in terms of communicating the goals? You know, whether that comes from top down, or whether it comes from bottom up, or how do you work that with across the business?
Yeah, so it's really both. So on the one hand side, always in, you know, the months, beginning of the months before a quarter ends, we sit together on an executive team and think about, okay, what did we achieve in the last quarter? And what are really the big topics for the next quarter? So we do also have strategic offsites where twice per year we get together and think more about the midterm, long-term vision. But these ones are really the quarterly, based on the midterm, long-term vision. What should be the priority topic for the next quarter? And we kind of high level define them at this very moment already, and already start communicating them into the company, so that then every single team member can think about, okay, in my area, what could I potentially do that links towards the big company goals? And obviously not every single OKR links to the big overarching company goal, but the vast majority do. And then it's really, you know, team by team, quite time intensive process, but I believe that this, you know, alignment process, this thinking about what did we achieve in the last quarter? Why did we potentially change priorities during the quarter? And then, sitting with the team to define, this is really what we as a team want to commit to for the next quarter. I think that's always a very, very good exercise. I usually try to combine in my teams, I try to combine that also with an offsite, be it a real offsite or some digital version of it, but to really take a full day to go through this and really rather have the team then come up with the goals that where we say, hey, this is what we want to achieve in the next quarter. And and then we at the very beginning of a quarter, we always do like a mise en place meeting, as we call it, where we communicate the high level goals for the company and for all regions towards the teams. Plus a few midterm projects that we have, like a sustainability project, for example. And we always give updates and say, hey, for the next quarter, this is going to be our focus topic here.
I see. Okay, that makes sense.
And then the Q&A session as well. It's part of our Friday all hands on deck meeting. It's a dedicated one to that 1.5 hours, really, where we only talk about next quarter's goals and last quarter's achievements or fails. And where it's a big Q&A session where people can ask a lot of questions.
Okay, yeah, that's great. Then obviously everybody gets the visibility as to what's actually going on across all the various parts of the business.
Absolutely. Excellent. And I mean, the goals are visible, of course, as well. I mean, everyone can go into the tool. Everyone can look at any time what's your particular goal, what's their company, or what's in this team, what are they working on with biggest priority. So that's, of course, also nice that you have this constant visibility in the tool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, excellent. Great. And obviously, as you continue to grow, you know, this alignment is going to obviously become, you know, so important as the company continues to scale. And what are some of the other challenges that you have faced as the company has grown, in terms of headcount, obviously, that you've really had to overcome?
So we had a few, you know, tough situations when it came to restructuring. You know, we in the course of 6 years, obviously, there is events or there is moments when certain teams are being restructured. We had fulfillment sites or fulfillment centers where we had to close down certain sites because it was more they became too small and we had to find a new place. And sometimes a new place for a fulfillment center was not in the same region. And this is, of course, from a people operations perspective, but also for me as a founder, always a tough decision to, you know, to go towards team members and say, listen, this particular position will unfortunately not exist anymore. And then, of course, you try to offer. We also had this situation when we built a short service center in Lisbon, where we had a number of really fantastic team members, where we said each and everyone is more than welcome to join us on this and come with us to Lisbon. But obviously, not everyone was able to for personal reasons. So these are, of course, challenges where that are moments that are tough, that are not fun. And I always found, you know, the most important part in this was a very, very open, transparent communication from as early on as possible, and show people that you genuinely care and that you try to find a solution for them. But I mean, obviously you have to accept that you will not be able to find a solution for everyone. So that was like, you know, we had a few of these events. And then obviously, you know, you kind of need to reinvent culture on a continuous basis when you grow this quickly. And as I said earlier, 5 people, 50 people, 500, 1500. Culture is changing all the time. And that is a big challenge. It can be a lot of fun as well, but you really have to think hard. How can this culture continue to grow? And it really has a lot to do with how you recruit. Our whole team is involved in every single recruitment process. How you onboard people, and in the end, how you give autonomy to people to build that culture and help build this culture on a daily basis.
Interesting. And when you speak about reinventing culture, are there any kind of formal processes that you've been through along the way on the journey? I don't know, perhaps have you sort of like redefined your values at some point, or is there anything that you have had to kind of completely overhaul or redocument when it comes to the culture? Or would you say it's more iterative based on, you know, kind of small tweaks here and there to improve the culture in certain directions?
I would say it's definitely more iterative. So we have changed our values, and we always tell new team members when we onboard them, hey, these are our values. We try to work according to them, and every single day we also fail on them every single day, and it's fine as long as we keep reminding each other and trying to hold each other accountable to them. We always tell them, if there is something that you don't like, approach us, let's change them. You know, nothing is set in stone. So we have changed them in the past a bit, not massively, to be honest. We had them really since day one, and we've changed the wording here a little bit, and we've added a few things that we thought were missing, or that team members thought were missing. That was certainly more of an iterative process. We are constantly, you know, as part of every major, every strategy offsite that we have, and we're always talking about these topics. I mean, especially after dinner, over a couple of bottles of wine or so. But it is a constant topic for us. But we did not really have this massive overhaul, no.
Okay, and so you mentioned then, obviously, it comes down to onboarding and training and things like that. Are there any like big standout changes that you made along the way that you think were particularly big levers for changing or improving the culture?
I believe one of the biggest
changes that we made was the recruitment process. I mentioned that earlier on, that now we really involve the team. In the first 2 years of Marley Spoon, we hired very quickly, very traditionally, maybe, that the team lead just said, hey, that person sounds interesting. And the person started the next day. And that worked in some cases, and in others, obviously, it did not. I mean, which I guess is normal. But at some point, we said, no, we would like to have this hiring process a bit more objective and include more team members. I believe as soon as you include more team members, it does become automatically more objective, because unfortunately, we all have our biases, and we like someone, dislike someone, usually within the first 30 seconds that we speak to someone. Mm-hmm. So it is very difficult to to ignore or to be aware of these biases that you have and then ignore them. That process we changed probably after 2 years or so. This new process we already now have it since 4 years or so. But the responsibility for hiring remains with team leads. It's not a culture and people operations department that's responsible for hiring. That was always something that was very important for us. So the team lead itself is really responsible to build his team, to build the best team. Mm-hmm. That's really his main number one priority. And he's doing skill interviews and thinking about, okay, do we need to do some kind of challenge with that candidate or. But then once that box is ticked, we have a round of cultural interviews where really at least three team members from any team potentially come in and ask a bunch of questions based on our company values. And it's really, we don't tell the team members which questions to ask. We give them an idea. We say, okay, I mean, the team lead basically decides you go for topic 1 to 3 or area 1 to 3, you go for area 4 to 6 and the last 1, 7 to 9. And then there is a bunch in all of these areas. There is a bunch of potential questions that you could ask, but at the end, you're completely free to ask whatever you want to. But we do recommend if you do multiple cultural interviews, that you always ask the same kind of question, so yeah, that you are also less biased and that you can also objectivize the answers a little bit, and then try to really dig deep using like a STAR methodology, where try to get to the situation, task, action, result, yeah. And this process then goes on to a hiring committee where everyone gets together. Only if everyone agrees, we then move on to a final interview, to CEO interview, and then to extend an offer. So this is the hiring process is probably, or it's at least one of the things that changed massively since we started. And I really believe for the better, because I really believe that people that now join usually are a very good cultural fit. And it's at the end for both sides, of course, always very painful if you have to decide, if you realize one of the two sides realizes after a few months that it's not a fit. So I think we've been able to really improve on that.
Yeah, absolutely. That's really interesting. And then with the cultural questions, are those questions defined by the people and culture team?
Oh, we have them since a long time. Yes, I believe so.
Yeah. And are the interviewers then, are they then like, what's the word I'm looking for? They're then basically evaluating the candidate against a set rubric, or, are there certain things that they are looking for in a candidate's answer that they're then evaluating against the question?
No, it's really, we have our values, and then let's take an example. One of our values is to be data driven. So that could be an area for question. If you would be doing the cultural interviews with candidate X, Y, Z, we would say, okay, this is one area for you. And the other one is
to be, I don't know, to build the best team. And the third one would be work autonomously and entrepreneurial, etc. And then within each of these areas, we would give you, again, a number of questions that you could potentially ask, but you don't have to. If you have a great question, it's really just to help people, to give them a bit of guidance how to conduct these cultural interviews. We do train on these cultural interviews as well, because we really try to involve every single team member here.
Okay, excellent. And so as you continue to grow, what are some of the challenges that you are already foreseeing that you might need to overcome?
I mean, currently we're facing the same situation as everyone else. And it's not necessarily that much growth related, but this whole remote work or hybrid work is, of course, a very big topic for us that we expect to continue at least for the next year. But probably this hybrid work setup will remain. We are planning to offer that indefinitely to our team members. We've seen in internal surveys that a lot of team members very much enjoy the flexibility to also work from home. But the flexibility to work from home also has a downside, that actually the majority of our team members work much more than before, and a lot of them don't take proper breaks, because it's easy, in the morning to just grab your laptop, sit down, start typing away, and then all of a sudden you realize it's 8 in the evening and you haven't taken a proper break, and you work 10 hours straight or so, and that's of course not healthy and not sustainable. So that's a big topic, and we do also see that in internal surveys that people say they are they feel stressed, that work-life balance is a topic. So that's a big one for us, where we're trying to work on, that we're working on, trying to lead by example, give people tools. And also in that context, of course, onboarding new team members, creating this glue, creating the culture. We have a very good, solid culture built over the last couple of years. And that helps us, of course. But whenever you bring on new team members, they don't, and that might potentially work fully remotely or almost fully remotely. That's a different situation. So that, I believe, will remain a challenge for the upcoming years. And then, as you said, we are growing strongly, that has a lot of challenges on its own. A lot of processes where we are still working very agile at this point will need to be more formalized, and that always comes at a cost as well.
Yeah. Do you have any examples of that already come to mind?
I mean, compensation is one of these. It comes, compensation fairness is a very important part in perception. How happy are you with work? And this is a topic that always comes up, and it's much easier in a smaller team where people know each other, and we're not transparent as some companies are. We don't have full transparency on salary. But people, tend to have a good idea about, they speak to each other, et cetera. And that's okay. And I believe while it's a small team, they understand much better contributions. But it's also not just the cash component of remuneration. And some people, we also have an equity component in our remuneration scheme. And also some people choose to go for a position where they might have see exceptional growth, learning and development for themselves, and don't necessarily go for the highest cash option, et cetera, et cetera. So the larger the team gets, the more difficult, of course, it is to know this about the next person and the other person. Then you start wondering, and you're like, am I really fairly compensated? So there is, of course, this is one of the topics where we're discussing what
will we do as a next step, external benchmarking data, et cetera, et cetera. Diversity and inclusion in this context is of course also a big one. We have a super diverse culture when it comes to nationalities. I believe we have over 50 different nationalities working in the Berlin team alone, and we love that. And we always, in our internal surveys, score very highly on any diversity and inclusion question. At the same time, though, we haven't in the past formally looked at this in a way as to female leadership participation. We've changed that about a year ago, and going forward, I think we'll have the majority of exec team members will be women at Marley Spoon. Our board members are majority women as of today. But there's a lot of other areas where we haven't really looked into in the past. If you look at the Black Lives Matter discussion in the United States, we have a huge US team, and ethnicity wasn't a topic for us in the past. We did not, or not one that we actively discussed. And probably we need to. This is all, again, based on the larger you get, you need to think more and more about these kind of processes.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, all extremely important topics, obviously, as you say, to tackle as you keep scaling. And I'd love to jump back quickly to the internal surveys that you mentioned. How frequently are you running them? What kinds of things are you asking? And how do you use that data?
So we have twice per year, we run a global survey where, which is fairly extensive, 50 plus questions or so. We're really touching pretty much all areas. And that one we run truly globally to be able to benchmark also regions and teams against each other. And then pretty much after that, it's very, very different. There is, pulse surveys on a team level happening on a weekly basis, or like during height of Corona, we really sent out surveys on a weekly basis to understand, hey, how are you coping with the situation? How are you doing? There is monthly regional topics where, in Europe, we might have a different topic than that's pressing at the moment than in the US or in Australia, etc. So it's really starting from these two huge biannual ones into small local pulse surveys on a very frequent basis. And that, of course, also then defines what we do with the data. So there are these big biannual surveys. We try to sync them in a way that we always have that data available for our strategy offsite meetings. Mm-hmm. So we can use fresh data to really see, hey, what are the pain points? What are the celebration points? But also what are pain points? How did they develop over time? And define action items based on these. And other than that, we really try to be very democratic with the data that we have of these survey results. So they are available readily so that the individual team leads can compare themselves also to other teams and say, what does this result actually tell me? Am I doing good with this result, or am I here better or worse than the average at Marley Spoon? Who are good people that I could go turn to learn from them, to understand why, I don't know, if my team is doing particularly well, work bad and work-life balance, mm-hmm. I might look for someone that has a good score and discuss with that person, hey, how do you manage? Why are you, is your team perceiving that situation very different from my team?
Yeah.
I think that is probably the most important, this really very granular follow-up. And the big high-level, company-level one is also important, of course, not to miss any major trends, but it's really this working on a very local, granular level where I believe you can have the quickest wins.
Okay, that makes a lot of sense. And obviously the employee engagement metrics are obviously something that, as you said, like you and your team can use for taking to the strategy offsites And obviously that's something that you keep an eye on. Are there any other big metrics or how else would you define success for you in your role as head of culture?
I mean, the NPS, as you already mentioned, is of course a very, very important one. So at the end, all the survey data around engagement, recognition, growth, well-being, the cultural topics, that's really one of the main KPIs that we look at. And then, of course, there is the lagging indicators like turnover and tenure. That is, of course, something that we look at. Exit poll surveys that we do with team members that leave us. Why do they leave us? Where do they go? But this is all rather the lagging indicators. The leading indicators is really the surveys that we try to run very, very frequently.
Okay.
And of course, also very, you know, soft data as well. You know, just coffee chats where, like, you know, you get feedback from people or over a beer after work. I do believe that is also very, very important.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, those qualitative conversations that you are never going to show up in surveys.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Interesting. And then finally, how do you see the role of people operations developing? Are there any like trends that you're particularly excited about for the future?
I think that what we've seen over the last few years is that this whole field becomes much more data driven. You know, using analytics to then deliver insight and deliver impulse towards the wider team. I believe that's a very exciting part of what's happening in our area. I guess, you know, that you can really then extend to all potential areas. I mean, it goes to workforce planning, to talent acquisition and talent management overall, performance and succession planning. I mentioned diversity and inclusion topic before. Learning and development is, of course, is a huge one for us as well, where you have a ton of new opportunities nowadays with blended learning. I think there is a number of very, very exciting trends. But at the end, it's really trying to objectivize what you do and trying to build business cases around projects that you do and really trying to not fuzzily talk about are our people happy, but to you know, be able to show this has actually a great impact on the bottom line.
Yes. Yeah. Interesting. So yeah, really, it sounds like, you know, connecting the work that the people operations teams are doing to the whole strategic objective of the business and how that, as you say, really, really connects to profitability.
Yeah, I mean, it is like, I mean, we see it, you know, really starting at our fulfillment centers, you know, where, you know, bulk of our 1,000 out of 1,500 team members are the production associates. You know? They are the most important ones to ensure that our customers are happy. At sites or at fulfillment centers where we have a higher turnover rate, we see it immediately in complaint rates and also in productivity. And so if, you know, we manage to keep them happy and show them career passing, et cetera, we see it immediately in complaint rates and productivity. So it's really very, very simple math to do. And it's the same at all our offices. People can work everywhere on this planet nowadays. Now we have, you know, as I said before, people from all over the world working here, but they could be working, you know, tomorrow. They could go somewhere completely else. You need to give them a reason to be working for Marley Spoon, and that's you know, working on that culture and having an exciting challenge for them and working on an important topic.
Yeah, absolutely. Excellent. Well, that was a really nice note to end on. Just one final question from my side. Do you have a book or any other sort of resource recommendation that you would recommend our audience to check out?
So book, I
I do believe I have to stick to the, you know, the classic Lencioni 5 dysfunctions of a team. That's, you know, it's a very quick read, but that's, you know, not just for people operations, but really for everyone in business, because it really explains why, you know, trust is so important and why this is really the underlying function. And because it's so nice and simple, I like it a lot, and that's why it's like probably the one book that I would always recommend.
That's a good one, and we will link to that in the show notes. So thank you for that recommendation. Till, this has been an amazing conversation. Thank you very much for joining us, and I hope you've had fun as well.
Yeah, thank you very much, and it's been a pleasure.
Thanks for listening to this episode of People Over Perks by Leapsome. We're available on the Leapsome YouTube channel and all major podcasting platforms, so you can hit subscribe to receive each episode as it's released. We also have an email newsletter and a Slack community where you'll find great resources and discussions on how to build a high-performing, humane and diverse company culture. You can find the link in the show notes, or you can head to the resources section at leapsome.com. Thanks for joining us, and see you next time.